All right, so this morning I had the opportunity to preach in two services, which is like a pastor's dream. So I don't know if this will be the same as first service, but we're just going to try it and see. But we had an awesome time at 9 o'clock this morning, and God moved, and people got saved, and it was incredible. So that is my hope for today as well, because it's Easter. And we are going to continue this morning. We're going to end a series we started a few weeks ago called It Is Finished. And all April long, we've been looking at this concept of what the blood of Christ did on the cross, what when he cried out those words, it is finished, what it meant for us. If you were here on Thursday night, a part of our communion experience, we talked about what the Last Supper represented. And then Friday night, we talked about what the cross looked like. But this morning, it's not Thursday or Friday anymore. It's Sunday. And here's the thing about being a follower of Jesus. By the way, if you're here and you're not a follower of Jesus and you're just checking it out, you are so welcome. You're welcome to listen. You're welcome to think that I'm crazy, whatever you want. But I'm just glad you're here. And I'm just believing that God will get through to you today. Not like get through to you, but like God will show you his love in such a way that you can't deny his working in you. But for those of you that have followed Jesus for a long time, our faith hinges on today. Because if we have the cross, but we don't have the resurrection, then everything that Jesus said was a lie. And so on Good Friday, when Jesus laid down his life for us and he paid the penalty of death and sin and everything that he bought with his life and with his blood would not matter if he had stayed dead. Because the resurrection is what proves that he was who he said that he was. There's all kinds of, you can look through history and all kinds of different world religions and world leaders that proclaim to be a God or a Messiah of some point. But if you watch them, none of them came back from the dead. And so when people ask me all the time, why do you follow Jesus? I always come down to because I can't find anybody else that's still alive. And it's not just the Bible that proves that history. There's history encounters and there's books and there's writers and authors and theologians who have things dating back to over 2,000 years ago of people that saw him come back to life. And that's why we follow Jesus as Christians. And if you say, well, I just don't know if I think that's true. I'm a little skeptical of it. Here's what I would say to you. If you die and then come back and live for 2,000 years, we'll talk. Because I said in first service that people are like, well, people have gotten raised from the dead. In fact, I've heard of encounters all over the world, especially in the last 20 years, where people are getting raised from the dead because God is doing an awesome work on the earth. But even the people that are raised from the dead at some point in old age die. They're not here 2,000 years later. But Jesus got off the cross, went into the tomb, and came out on Sunday morning. And 40 years later, he ascended back into heaven and is still alive, sitting in heaven. And his work was finished for you and I. That's some good news this morning. Because I don't know about you, but I'm pretty jacked up. Right? I got some brokenness in my life. Someone's excited over there. I understand. I got some brokenness in my life. I'm dealing right now with a sore throat. I've preached 7 times this week, and I think my body is just like, can you take a little break? And I'm dealing with a sore throat. But you know what the thing is? What we just sang this morning, it doesn't matter what I feel. It doesn't matter what I see. My hope will always be your promise is in me. And his promise says in Isaiah 53 that by his stripes I am healed. So it doesn't matter what I feel. I stand on his promise. That's what the resurrection did for you and I. And so this morning, I want to talk to you out of a passage. We're going to look at 2 different passages, one in Revelation and one in John. If you want to turn your Bibles this morning to Revelation chapter 12, we're going to look at verses 10 and 11. It says, I'll give you a minute to get there. I hear pages ruffling. That's so weird because usually, you know, it's iPhones. Some of y'all brought some Bibles. That's pretty cool. It's really good to come to church. It's a good thing. Revelation chapter 12. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Messiah. For the accuser of our brothers and sisters, that's the enemy, the devil, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down. Whoo! You guys aren't excited about that as I am. Okay, here's the thing. I've told you guys, I get coached. I love life coaching. And my life coach talks to me all the time about a saboteur. right? Which in a lot of ways is just the enemy whispering things, or yourself whispering things to yourself about what you can't do. And so one day she said to me, what are we going to do with that little peon? Because she calls him mini DJ. What are we going to do with him? And I was like, you know what we're going to do? We're gonna look at him and we're going to squash him. And every time he whispers, you can't do it and you don't have what it takes and you'll never amount to anything and you can't be forgiven and you got to live with that shame, I'm just going to go, because he's been hurled down, because God has overcome him. He's been hurled down. So they triumphed. One translation says they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. We have overcome because God has overcome. And how we have overcome is, one, by the blood of the Lamb, but two, by the word of our testimony. You see, I think sometimes in church, we act like we know that God overcame and he forgave us and he prepared heaven for us and he brings us kingdom here on earth and all the things that we say in the church to make ourselves feel like we're smart, or at least act like it, or we Google like a verse and we just get up in the morning and like, I should put a Bible verse on Instagram so people think I'm spiritual. And so Bible verse for today, and then I put it up there, right? And like, we're like in this little mode where we're like, yeah, I know that Jesus paid it all for me. But we stay right there. And so the problem is, we don't just overcome right there. We overcome through what he did, but also by what we speak. And also by what we say and what we proclaim in our life. So this Easter morning, I want to read a story to us from John chapter 20, if you want to turn there this morning. And this is the encounter of the empty tomb with Mary Magdalene, knowing that she, or learning from her, that we overcome through the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. This is one of the coolest Easter passages, I think. John chapter 20, it says, early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, they have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him. So Peter and the other disciples started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb. He was persistent. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the burial cloth that had been around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded up by itself, separated from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had risen from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes, but Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. "Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and sisters and tell them, I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the other disciples with the news. "I have seen the Lord," she told them, that he had said these things to her. We find Mary at this place, at the tomb, with a few other disciples there. They had heard Jesus tell of his future. They knew that Jesus said that he would live, but then at some point he'd be persecuted unto death and he would die. And then 3 days later, he would rise again. But if you've ever been in relationship with someone really close to you and something really bad happens to them, when you start seeing them come out of that bad place, oftentimes it's really hard to admit that it's gotten better. Right? Oftentimes you look at what has happened and what is going on in the situation, and you're like, man, that's gotten better, but now I'm just waiting for it to get bad again. I think that's where we find Mary in this point. John looks in the tomb and he sees the linen separated, and there's some significance to the linen being separated in that if one of the thoughts was that Jesus' body could have been stolen. But I don't know if you've ever been robbed, but typically when people rob you, they don't leave it in order. Like one time my car got broken into and there was just stuff all over the car. It wasn't like they just nicely figured out how to open that lock and then took a few CDs and, you know, some change and then shut the door. It was everything in the glove box was on the floor of my car. And when they got to that tomb and the tomb was empty, but the linens were folded, what that told them was this was not just someone carried the body away. This was actually someone who had gotten up and took the time to fold the cloths to put them back the way they needed to be as a sign that he was alive to them. And so John, the Bible says, goes in and believes. And then him and Peter go back. I don't know if Peter believed, or Peter's just always a loud blabbermouth, so he just probably thought, well, I'm going to go with John and say what he has to say because I just like to talk, kind of like me. And so, just being real. So us talkers are like, I don't know if it's true or not, but I'm going to tell somebody something, and they're going to think it's awesome or not awesome, and I don't really care because at least I get to talk. And so Peter and John go running off, but Mary stays at the tomb. What's interesting about Mary is that there's speculation that Mary could have been a prostitute. And if this is the same Mary that washed Jesus' feet with her tears and dried them with her hair, this woman had a bond and a connection to Christ. She was in relationship with him and loved him so much and believed that he was her God and believed that he had set her free and had experienced the love that only people who truly encounter Christ can experience. And I think there was something in her. It wasn't that it was doubt, like she didn't actually believe he was there. I just don't think she actually could get herself to admit that it might be the way he said. And so she stays at the tomb, and she goes in, and these two angels sit there, and they say, why are you crying? And she's like, because Jesus is gone. And then she hears this voice behind her. If you truly know God, you will know God's voice. And you will know when God calls your name. You see, there's an interesting thing that happened here where she hears the voice of Jesus and she turns around and she doesn't recognize him. The problem is that if you've ever encountered someone that has been in a horrific accident or has been totally abused or is bruised everywhere, if you see them again in a couple days, you don't expect them to look good. You don't expect them to look glorified. You expect to walk into a hospital room and see someone beat up to shreds because you just saw this guy, the last picture in your head was him hanging on a cross, and now he's standing there in his glory and saying, Mary. So she didn't recognize him, but she knew his voice. Because when you know Christ, you know his voice. And there's nothing like the voice of God talking to you. It's not always an audible voice. It's not always a voice that you hear. But there's this assurance, this knowing in your heart that God is saying, DJ, I got this. You typically find it in a place in your life where you feel so confused or so broken or so far away from where you need to be, and you hear this voice that just says, DJ, I got this. I'll hold you. I'll take care of you. Now go and tell everyone else that I'm here. And so Mary, knowing it's Jesus, gets up, and I'm sure her temptation was to want to stay with him. If you ever had someone you love dragged away, you don't want to let him go. You want to hold on to him if you find him again. And no, I can't let you go. But Jesus says to Mary, no. You've got to go now and tell my brothers and sisters that I am alive. And so Mary goes to proclaim what she has seen. And this morning, what I want to talk to us on the topic of is the fact that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb, but also by the word of our testimony. We overcome by proclaiming what Jesus has done for us. We overcome by telling others of what Jesus did on the cross, but not just what he did on the cross, also what he did for you. And my question for you this morning is, do you have a God story? Do you have a time with God where you've encountered him in such a way that you can't deny it was him and you heard his voice speak to you? Do you know him, and are you letting him write your story? Or are you still over here saying, I believe that I've been forgiven. I believe that things are good, but I'm not going to tell anybody about it because they might think I'm weird. I'm not going to share my story because they might not totally understand it. I'm not going to talk about my faith. I'm going to keep it way down here and just kind of just bottle up here, and it's just me and God. But that's not the way God designed it. If Jesus wanted to be the one to proclaim who he was to the entire world, he'd still be here. He wouldn't have gone back to heaven to God and said to us, go and make disciples. But because Jesus said, I want to give you all the authority, I want to give everything to you, now you go into all the world and preach the gospel and tell them that I'm alive and baptize them and all the things he called us to do, he did it because he intended for us to be the ones to share our story. And maybe in your life this morning, you feel really defeated. And you're like, but I believe what you're saying about Jesus. I believe he overcame. I believe that he died on the cross. I believe that he rose again, but I'm still living in defeat. Can I ask you this morning, what are you doing with what you believe? Because the world around us is not going to know who he is unless we tell them. Romans chapter 10, verse 13 says that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. But how then can they call on the one they have not believed? And how can they believe in the one whom they've not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can anyone preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. But not all the Israelites accepted the good news. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our message? Consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word of Christ. Are you sharing your God story with those around you? I was thinking this week about how different our community would look if we would all just start sharing our story. I think sometimes we're scared to share it because you're like, yeah, you don't know the mess I still live in, right? I can't share what God did for me a year ago because I'm dealing with this crap right now, right? I can't go and tell you what God did because he did it then, but I don't know how it's impacting me now. But I want to challenge you this morning that the world needs to hear your story of what God has done for your life. And how will they know it unless we tell them? Because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And so as I was thinking about it this week, I thought, you know what? If we really as the church, like the church of Christ on the earth, actually did this and believe that we didn't just overcome because of what he did, but we also overcome in sharing it because our words have power. And every time we share faith, we are pushing out doubt. And every time we share God's promise, we're pushing away the enemy. And so by sharing our story, we're also rekindling our faith to say, God, thank you for what you've done. And what if we did that in our community? Walmart would feel different. Churches wouldn't just feel different. Walmart would feel different. Any store you go into, any place of business, any school, whatever your workplace is, would feel so much different if you truly walked in saying, thank you, God, that you overcame on the cross, and now I'm going to share my story so we can overcome the enemy. What if you shared your story? Think of the change it would bring to our cities. So we overcome by his blood and by our testimony. Are you sharing your story? I want to give you a few things to write down this morning on this Easter Sunday about your story, because the thing about Easter is we can come to church and we can clap our hands and we can put on our shirt to make us look like an Easter egg. Thank you, Janet. She's like, you look like an Easter egg. And I'm not talking about your head. Thank you, Janet. Poor lady has to hear me complain every day about my fat head. So she's like, you look like an Easter egg, not your head, your shirt. Just keep for the record. But if we come into church and we just go home and hang out with our families and have an Easter dinner and have our Easter egg hunts and do all the things that we do for fun on Easter, but we let Easter stay here, we've missed the whole point of the gospel. Jesus didn't just die so we could stay where we were. He died so we could step into the destiny of going into all the world and watching the gospel transform the world. So a few things you can write down this morning about your story is that your story can inspire someone who is hurting. Your story can inspire someone who is hurting. You say, but I'm hurting. That's okay. The story of what God is doing, even in the process, people can learn from your failures. People can learn from your mistakes. People can learn from the places that you've screwed up and done all these things where you're just like, I can't do this anymore, and I don't know that God actually is who he said he is. And then at some point, he stepped in. And maybe everything wasn't changed, but this one situation was changed, and you can use that story to help someone who is hurting. What is your story of what God has done for your life? Don't just keep him on the cross or at the empty tomb, but go and proclaim your story to someone who is hurting. The next one to write down is that your story can impact someone's life who is hopeless. Your story can impact someone's life who is hopeless. This week, we got a call last Sunday during church that Kelsey's grandmother was not doing well, and they were going to put her in hospice. And so we went home after church and packed up and drove up to Grand Rapids, Michigan, and went in to see Gigi, we call her, great-grandma Gigi. That's what Weston calls her. And we got into the hospital room where she was getting ready to go on hospice, and Kelsey's mom went and drew a picture with Weston. If you don't know Weston, he's my 22-month-old son, and he's the most adorable kid. I know I'm biased, but he's the most adorable kid you've ever seen. And the older he gets, the more I'm enjoying this parent thing. Like, it's so much fun. Yesterday, we just played all day in the sandbox that had no sand in it yet because Daddy forgot to buy it. And so we were just out playing in our sandbox with our buckets in the air. It was imagination. And so Weston... But Weston is like, he's so much fun. And so we walk in to this hospital room where Kelsey's grandma is slowly dying and transitioning from this life to the next. And she's living an awesome life. And she's 87 years old. And so it's not like one of those things where we're like, oh no, like we didn't see this coming. Like, we knew her health was progressively going that way. And so we walk in the hospital room, and Weston had drawn her a picture. And he starts drawing. He went in and traced his hand with his grandma. And he brings the picture, and he comes marching in. And he goes, Gigi! Gigi! And hands her this picture, and her face just lit up. Like, just lit up. Like, she came to life for this little baby. And then the next day, we went back to see her again before we left, and she was just, like, non-responsive. And then she passed away on Wednesday night. So when Kelsey's dad called us on Thursday morning, he said she had passed away in the night and was just telling Kelsey, and Kelsey was crying, and it's one of those moments, right? Her grandma lived with their family, so this is like she's very close to her grandma. But her name was Faith, and her dad said, you know what that lady did is she lived out her name. She lived in faith, and because of the hope that we have that this world isn't it, this is not all we get. Yes, it's important what you do here. Yes, I am not one of those pastors who thinks just raise your hand and accept Jesus and go do what you want. No, like, we are called to build the kingdom of God and live with passion and live abundant lives here on earth. But even all that we focus on and teach on in this world, it's like that and we're gone. And Kelsey's grandma lived with this faith, like her name, and this assurance that when she left this earth on Wednesday night, she was instantly in the presence of God. Your story can impact someone's life who's hopeless. Because there's a lot of people in your life, I guarantee you, who feel no hope. They're discouraged. They're ready to throw in the towel on life. They're ready to say, I can't take it anymore. I can't do it anymore. And by you simply going and saying, here's a story that happened to me, they can see Christ at work in you. The last one to write down is that your story can influence a generation of people who think that God's story is irrelevant. The love of Jesus Christ came into the world for all. And sometimes in the church, we've gotten so caught up on our agendas or our ideas or our things that we focus on. And what the church has done, I don't know if it's always with the wrong heart, but what the church has done on the earth is we've pushed the world away from that loving God by our own agendas. And instead of giving an all-inclusive grace of Jesus Christ who people can respond to and say, I want that. We've said, no, you have to do this, and you can't do this, and you can't do this, and you can't do this. And all these people are being pushed away from God. But I was thinking this week that it's easy for me, as someone who tries really hard not to push anyone away from God, to point my fingers at the people who do. It's easy for me to say it's those Christians. Those people over there who picket, and those people who bomb abortion clinics, and they're giving me a bad reputation. And I felt the Holy Spirit said to me this week, what about you? You can say you love everyone, but how often do you share your story? How often does the cross become so real in your life that you won't shut up about it? Not very often, if I'm being real. I mean, you count Sundays, I guess, once a week, right? And I talk to people here and there. But what if every time I encountered someone, I realized this is an opportunity for me to share what God has done in me and bring hope to their life? Because your story has the power to make a loving God relevant to a world who thinks his story is irrelevant. And so this Easter, as we close, I want to read a couple things to you. But I want to ask you this question as we wrap up today is, what has Jesus done for you? Last night, I just started writing down things that I know that he's done for me. There was a time in my life where I was pursuing everything that I wanted. And I knew God had told me that I was called to be a pastor, but I didn't like that because I thought pastors are poor and I need to be rich. And so I went to business school and I failed. And that's never a fun call to your parents. What do you mean you failed another class? Well, I mean, you know, school's fun and we go out to eat a lot, you know? Because I wasn't passionate about what I was studying because I was outside of what I knew God had told me to do, but I just wanted to figure it out on my own. And so sometimes when you hit rock bottom and you failed out of school and you don't have a job and you're kind of like, I'm 23 years old and what am I doing with my life? You surrender. And you say, okay, God, not my way, but your way. And from that day forward, what God has done for me is put dreams and visions in my heart that I can honestly stand before you this morning and say that I am living out my dreams. How many people can say that when you get up and go to work in the morning that you're living out what you love? I don't dread getting up. I wish we had 43 services. I would preach all day long, and if I lose my voice, I'd learn sign language and do it. Like, I would just keep going because I love what I do. But that's not because of what I did. It's because of what he did for me. And he showed me the grace, and he let me go and try to pursue everything that I didn't want to do or pursue the life that I thought I wanted, and he just waited. All right, figure it out. Enjoy those Applebee's appetizer sampler platters. Write tithe checks off your student loans that you'll still be paying back 10 years later. Good, just work it out. You're good. You got it. And then when I came to a point where I fasted and said, God, I really want to do what you want, God began to show me what I was called to do. Part of that is something else God did in my life. And part of that is he gave me Kelsey. She's working today. She's not here, but she's amazing. And Kelsey is one of those girls that people ask me all the time, how did a guy like you get a girl like that? I don't know. Favor ain't fair. That's all I got to say. But I got her. And it was a time in my life where I was like, God, I wasn't dating anybody. I just wasn't even pursuing a relationship. And I was like, God, if I'm going to be in ministry and I'm going to say yes to you, then I want a partner in life to do this with. So you got to find me someone. And I am not kidding. In 6 weeks' time, I met Kelsey and we were engaged. And 8 years later, we're still going strong. Not saying I recommend speed dating, but it worked for us. We were engaged for a year, just for the record. Jesus has shown up in our lives at times when we didn't have two nickels to rub together and been our daily bread. He's put me on platforms of people that I had no right standing on, with people that had degrees out their ears, and there's me. And I'm like, who am I here, and why are all these people here? And God just put the favor on my life. He gave us a house when we didn't even have the money to pay our rent. He healed my sister of cancer 21 years ago, and she's still cancer-free to this day, which is incredible. He brought my brother back to God when he was so far away. I could go on and on. He gave us peace and he gave us joy and he provided healing. And some of you have heard the story of Weston's birth, and he was premature, and all the, like, from the day one, it was like the enemy was just trying to stop his life from happening. But the kid just started getting, just kept getting better and better and better and better. And then last week, even they gave us a scare again and they told us what it could be. And that's what happens with when you deal with faith to fear, and all of a sudden you're overhearing what could be and you forget the promise of the cross and what God has done for you there to say that, no, I know what he can do. And you start living in the could be. And so instead of running to God or running to people and sharing the story of what God has done, we run to people and share what it might happen. Guys, our words have power. James says that life and death are in the power of the tongue. What are you saying about your salvation? What are you saying about your faith? Are you just showing up on Sunday saying thank you for the cross, and then on Monday being like, I just don't know why nothing's ever getting better? Maybe you should start talking like it's better and have the faith to believe that God will do the impossible for your life. And so this morning, as we close, I'm almost done, I promise. I want to read a sermon to you that was written by Dr. S.M. Lockridge. He was a pastor in San Diego, and he came to Detroit in 1976, and he preached this sermon. And some of you maybe heard it before, but I didn't want to leave here today saying, share your story, and not remind you of who God is and what Jesus did for your life. So listen to this. And I'll tell you what, if as you're listening to this, something resonates with you, feel free to clap, feel free to shout or stand up if you're like, man, that's what he did for me, and celebrate who he is. He says, my king was born king. The Bible says he's a seven-way king. He's the king of the Jews, that's an ethnic king. He's the king of Israel, that's the national king. He's the king of righteousness, he's the king of the ages. He's the king of heaven, he's the king of glory. He's the king of kings, and he's the Lord of lords. Now that's my king. Well, I wonder if you know him. Do you know him? Don't try to mislead me. Do you know my king? David said, the heavens can declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork. My king is the only one whom there are no means to measure that can define his limitless love. No far-seeing telescope can bring into visibility the coastline of the shore of his supplies. No barrier can hinder him from pouring out his blessing. He is enduringly strong. He's entirely sincere. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's imperial peaceful. He's impartially merciful. That's my king. He's the Son of God. He's the sinner's savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He stands alone in himself. He's honest. He's unique. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. He's supreme. He's preeminent. He's the greatest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He's the supreme power in higher criticism. He's the fundamental doctrine of historical theology. He's the carnal necessity of spiritual religion. That's my king. He's the miracle of the age. He's the superlative of everything good that you choose to call him. He's the only one able to supply all your needs simultaneously. He supplies strength for the weak. He's available for the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes and he saves. He's the almighty God who guides and keeps his people. He heals the sick. He cleanses the lepers. He forgives the sinners. He discharges debtors. He delivers the captives. He defends the feeble. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. And he beautifies the meek. That's my king. Do you know him? Well, my king is a king of knowledge. He's a wellspring of wisdom. He's the doorway of deliverance. He's the pathway of peace. He's the roadway of righteousness. He's the highway of holiness. He's the gateway of glory. He's the master of the mighty. He's the captain of the conquerors. He's the head of the heroes. He's the leader of the legislators. He's the overseer of overcomers. He's the governor of governors. He's the prince of peace. He's the king of kings. He's the lord of lords. That's my king. His office is manifold. His promise is sure. His light is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love changes. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. His yoke is easy and his burden is light. I wish I could describe him to you, but he's indescribable. That's my King. He's incomprehensible. He's invincible and he's irresistible. Do you know him? Whew. I'm coming to tell you this, that the heavens of heavens can't contain him, let alone some man explain him. You can't get him out of your mind, and you can't get him off your hands. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. The Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they found out they couldn't stop him. Pilate could not find any fault in him. The witnesses could not give their testimonies to agree about him. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him. And the grave couldn't hold him. That's my King. He always has been and always will be. I'm talking about the fact that no precedenter, and he'll have no successor. There's nobody before him and there'll be nobody after him. You can't impeach him and he's not going to resign. That's my King. Do you know him this morning? Come on and lift up a great big shout to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ, crucified, buried, and risen. We thank you, Jesus. You are our King of Kings. Stand to your feet with me this morning all over this room. I want to invite you to bow your heads and close your eyes. And I just want to ask you that simple question. Do you know him today? Because in order to share your story, you got to start a story with God. And some of you may have started one a long time ago, and the weight of life has just made you press away from God, and you're like, I don't think he is who he said he is. And you've read things that have questioned your faith and challenged your theology, and you're just, I just don't know if that's even relevant anymore. God seems kind of irrelevant to me. I want you to know today that no matter what any person has ever told you, Jesus Christ came into the world because he loved you, because he wanted to pay the price for everything you've done wrong. In that moment when he cried out, it is finished on the cross, he finished everything. You don't have to try harder anymore. You just love him deeper. And so this morning, if you're here all across this room with every head bowed and every eye closed, I want to give you an invitation to respond to the gospel. The kingdom of God is advancing on the earth. God is moving around the world. And if you say, I want to jump on that train of building his kingdom and surrendering my life to Christ and say, from this day forward, I'm giving it all to Jesus. Will you just shoot your hand up in the air right now so I can pray for you? Thank you. Thank you. Praise God. So Father, in this space this morning, as we gather to talk about who you are and what you did on the cross and the fact that you are alive and now we have life, I pray, Holy Spirit, that every person who raised their hand, and even those that may have wanted to but didn't, would encounter your radical love in their lives this week. Holy Spirit, I ask that you would make yourself through Jesus so real to them that they can't deny your power. They can't deny that you are God, that you gave your life for them so that they could live here on earth building your kingdom and forever in eternity, God. I thank you this morning for people who say, I want to be a Christian. I want to follow Jesus all the days of my life. And I pray, Father, today that you would give us the strength to do just that. And so I'm going to ask us this morning to pray a prayer out loud, and I'll ask everyone to join in. Just say, Dear Jesus, I thank you for the cross. I thank you for the finished work of Christ so I can live healed and whole. I thank you for your forgiveness. Forgive me now of all my sin and wash me with your blood. I confess with my mouth today that Jesus is Lord. And I believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead. So from this day forward, I will live for Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Let's put our hands together one more time and thank God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Well, thank you so much for joining us this Easter. The Bible says that whenever someone comes into the kingdom of God and gives their life to Jesus, there's a party in heaven for just one. And I'm telling you guys, there was like 12 hands here today. So you ought to go out of this church. Yeah. You ought to go out of this church partying like you never partied before, because we serve a risen Savior who loves us and gave his life for us and gives us the victory because he's alive. We love you guys. If you need prayer for anything in your life, there'll be prayer partners down here in the altar. It's your first time with us, check out our Connect desk. We'd love to tell you more about our church and get you connected in. And before we go, let's confess the blessing over ourselves and our week, that my best and most blessed days are ahead of me. Love you guys. Hope to see you back next week. Happy Easter.